Let's pray and start. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful morning you have given us on the Lord's Day, gathering together as a church to meditate on your word. Heavenly Father, we pray that you speak to our hearts, open the eyes of our hearts, and speak to us from your word, and help us not to be mere listeners, but be the doers of your word. And you be pleased with our obedience, and help us to review your word as we listen, because we are not listening to the world's news, we are not listening to man's opinions, we are listening to the word of God. And help us to fear and tremble and honor and submit to the authority of your word. We pray that you captivate our attention and particularly our hearts, so that we would be submissive to the proclamation of your word. We pray that you be with us, guard us, guide us, and use us for your glory. In the name of our beloved Savior, Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave his life for us on the cross, we offer this prayer. Amen. Amen. I'll be taking two sessions today. You know, basically, I'm a man of details and depth when I touch a subject. So, given a chance, I would take 5 hours to speak on this subject, each session 1 hour, because such is the importance that we find in the Word of God. But due to time constraint, we are having only 2 sessions. The first session on the scriptural declaration on the importance of the ministry of hospitality. And the second session, I will be dealing with the nitty-gritty details, the practical aspects of how we need to apply them. And I'm speaking not in the context of showing hospitality to unbelievers, which is different altogether, the way we practice it. And I can recommend you a book at the end, and maybe we can have one day on the importance of it, and especially those who are particularly gifted evangelistic in their hearts. But now we are only focusing on showing hospitality, cultivating this ministry in the context of the local church. Before I delve into this subject, there are 3 practical incidences that has happened, which I would like to share with you, which will really trigger the need for us to seriously consider the ministry of hospitality. I would like to begin with the story shared by Alexander Strock. And one of the book that I recommend you to read, and if you want to borrow, you can borrow from me, the book, which is a short book, The Hospitality Commands. And in that book, in page number 5, Alexander Strock shares this. He shares here, an elderly single woman who now attends our church related an experience to me that dramatically illustrates why we need fresh teaching on the subject of Christian hospitality. At one time in her life, she had to travel more than an hour by bus every Sunday to attend a small suburban church. Each week after the Sunday morning service, she would eat alone in a restaurant and then spend an entire afternoon in a park or library so that she could attend the evening service. She did this for 4 years. What left her with sour memories of the church was the fact that in 4 years, no one invited her home to eat a Sunday afternoon meal or to rest. It wasn't until she announced she was leaving that an elderly woman in the church invited her home for a meal on her final Sunday. That's the plight. This has happened in United States of America, but Indian churches are also not very unfamiliar to this, because for the Indian churches, it's all about the program. What happens for that 2 hours, that is what the church is all about. And there is another person, singer John Charles Thomas, at age 66, wrote to a columnist, Abigail Van Buren, I am presently completing the second year of a 3-year survey on the hospitality or lack of hospitality in churches. To date, of the 195 churches I have visited, I was spoken to in only one by someone other than an official greeter, and that was to ask me to move my feet. Only one person spoke in this 195 churches. Only one person. No one even greeted. Just to move the feet because it was on the way. What a sad thing it is. A Los Angeles Times writer visited Christian churches to see how friendly and loving they were. He rated his visitation experience according to this point system. The greeters at the door, that is the ushers at the door, got 2 points. The prepackaged form letter from the pastor got 3 points. The coffee hour got about 5 points. Personal invitations to dinner were about 60 points. Introducing yourself in a cordial, non-threatening way was about 10 points. The reporter's rating sheet shows how powerfully hospitality communicates love and concern. These are the 3 practical things that have happened. Keeping this in mind, I would like to go ahead and see what hospitality is. What is hospitality that we are talking about? A lot of people have many of you, I'm telling you that, all those many in the churches here are practicing hospitality, but I think we are talking about meaningful, purposeful, fruitful hospitality. And I would like to begin with the word, the Greek word for hospitality is philoxenos. Philoxenos, which means, philo is a word, or philia is a word, which means brotherly love. And xenos is the word which means stranger. And if you know the word xenophobia, it is nothing but the fear of strangers. And you know, when this word hospitality in Greek, it literally means loving strangers as your own family members. Loving strangers as your own family members. And hospitality was a great ministry followed in the early church, because of which we find that we are all strangers, right? We are all here, sitting here. We don't know one another. We are not born to the same womb. We are not born to the same family. We are being born from different families, coming from different cultures. And yet, why should we live together as a family of God where you have to practice hospitality? The Bible tells very clearly in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Shall we all read this together? Which speaks about the strangeness of our pre-Christian life and also the familial disposition that they say in the post-Christian life. Let's all read this together. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. The Bible tells that all of us in our pre-Christian life were strangers and aliens to one another. But it says, now you are fellow citizens and also members of the household of God. So when we practice loving one another and we see that hospitality is a great expression of our love for one another, it shares that we do that, although in Greek it is loving strangers and showing. But in reality, it is still the same. We are strangers and we have become members of the household of God. And how did we become? Ephesians 2 says very clearly, the only reason why we have become the family of God is not because of our common affinities. As sister says, you know, some people feel that commonness because they are of the same color. And some people feel commonness because of the same age. Some people feel common because of the same language. Some people feel common because of the same region. But that's worldly, carnal commonness that we find in the world that unites people. But if you look at the Bible, the only common thing that unites us, and Ephesians 2 argues, is the cross of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is the reason, it is to make us one family of God, that Christ laid his life, he shed his blood, he offered his body, and he bore our punishment on the cross so that we would become a family of the living God. John Piper puts this very well in one of his articles. He says here that the ultimate act of hospitality was when Jesus Christ died for sinners to make everyone who believes a member of the household of God. Follow the argument carefully. How gospel is the foundation for hospitality. We are no longer strangers and sojourners. We have come home to God. Everyone who trusts in Jesus finds a home in God. When we practice hospitality, we practice the refreshing joy of becoming conduits of God's hospitality rather than being self-decaying cul-de-sacs. The joy of receiving God's hospitality decays and dies if it doesn't flourish in our own hospitality to others. Now what he says in three things, I understand that there are some difficult terms for you to understand. There are three things that he is highlighting in the statement here. The first thing he says that salvation is nothing but hospitality. Why? Because God accepts us in his home. Eternal life, eternal home, heaven. What is heaven? Heaven is defined as the abode of God, the place where God dwells. And God has given us his home and his eternal life and his eternal home in the form of hospitality. And the second thing he says here is that there are two things that we have received home. One is in the church of God. The church is nothing but the family of God. So when believers have repented and when they become children of God, they find home in the church of the living God, in the family of God. And eventually, in the consummation on the last day, we will get into the physical abode of God where we will live eternally. And the third thing John Piper points out is, since we have received hospitality in the person Jesus Christ, and since we have become part of the family of God, eagerly waiting for our eternal abode, he says that we should become conduits, which is channel, tools, instruments in the hands of God to show that hospitality to one another and not become cul-de-sacs, which is the dead end of the road, which is you only enjoy hospitality from God and that's the end. Rather than what you have received from God, that hospitality you extend and flourish to others in the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. So what we need to understand, brothers and sisters, is this. A lot of people think that hospitality is just about food. What we need to understand is that therefore, when I thought about this, this is what people are doing. And I was thinking about this. I was thinking about how much deeply grateful we need to be for the people who show hospitality to us, which we generally take it for granted. Therefore, listen, hospitality is sharing the things we value most. First is, you know, family. When you are showing hospitality, you are sharing your family. My wife is involved. My sons are involved. And the family is involved in showing that hospitality. And we are sharing home. We are inviting people home. And we are sharing our home with them. And not only that, it is money. So much of money is spent when we show hospitality. Honestly speaking, I don't want to boast about it. We spend thousands of money every month for hospitality. Thousands, I say that. When I take the count of it, the way we spend it, thousands. We spend every month as a family in hospitality, which we can use for savings for our own family comforts. But hospitality costs money. Food. We share food. And even privacy. Do you know that? Every time we are telling, come into my home and take my time and take my family's privacy, you know what we are doing is we are showing a great sacrifice for them. Time is something that we are really sharing, the privacy and time and even energy. All those who really show hospitality know that how physically exhausting it is. How exhausting it is to clean before. How exhausting it is to cook the food. And how much more exhausting it is to clean it after everyone leaves. That is one of the reasons why so many would like to stay away from the ministry of hospitality, because they love comforts than taking efforts. And then also ultimately put together, people, listen to this. When people are showing hospitality, in one statement we can say that they are sharing their lives with you. Don't take the ministry of hospitality for granted. We should be immensely grateful for that. Let's quickly get into the scripture in order for us to go through some of the important passages for us to consider. I would like to begin with Acts chapter 2, verse 46 to 47, where we see how in the early church, hospitality, right after they were born again, right after when we see the gospel was born in the hearts of the people, we know that Acts chapter 2 is the inaugural of the gospel proclamation by Peter, and about 3,000 people came to the Lord. Many people focus on, you know, some of the signs and wonders that have happened, and the teaching and breaking of the bread and prayers. But one thing we neglect in 46 and 47 is this. Hear this carefully, people. It didn't happen once a month or once in a year or once in a few months. It says day by day, which in other words, every day. These born-again people continued with one mind in the temple. They were gathering in the Jewish temple for a while. And then it says here that every day, breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together. Can you imagine this? Every day these people were eating at the homes of different people. They were gathering in the homes every day and they were having meals. Imagine the sacrifice those families have made for one another. And they did this with gladness, not with grumbling. Oh, every day. You know how many people grumble here? When we have two, three times the participation of the week, even that too online. Okay? Oh, so many activities. Once we want to show up only on Sunday. That's the reason I say that many of you would not be a part of the early church if you were living in the first century, because they were radical in their church commitment, which we don't see in the present day churchianity. They gathered, they were excited, they were not taking it as a burden. With gladness and sincerity, they were praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. What a grand scripture that we see here, how they were baptized, immersed into the ministry of hospitality. One of the great signs of people who are really walking with the Lord. One of the great signs of people who are being filled with the Holy Spirit. One of the great signs of people who are devoted to the Christian doctrine and practice, that is the ministry of hospitality. You observe that they were doing that at homes. Elizabeth Newman, author, mentions here that hospitality without a home is an oxymoron, which is, you can't think about hospitality without home. Now, why I'm saying this? Because you should be careful that although it is some sort of hospitality when you send food to someone, which is good, some sort of it, but that is not true hospitality in a sense, biblical sense. Hospitality without home is an oxymoron. It is not true. In other words, it's a contradiction. There is no hospitality without home. It is only when we invite people home and share our time, energy, privacy, and everything. That is the true sense of hospitality that we find in Acts chapter 2, verse 46 to 47. Gustav Stalin, who is also a good author, he mentions that one of the most prominent features in the picture of early Christianity, which is so rich in good works, is undoubtedly its hospitality. That is one of the great things of the early church. If you look at the churches today, we can't say that. Hey, tell me 5 marks of the churches that we find here. What are the 5 great marks of the Ekklesia Evangelical Fellowship? Or any other church to name. Does hospitality fall into that? It does. in the early church. Alexander Strock mentions here, based on the word of God here, brotherly love, however, entails intimate relationship, care for one another, knowledge of one another, belonging together, and sharing life together. We cannot know or grow close to our brothers and sisters. Now hear this, brothers, carefully. This is a very important point that modern day churchgoers should understand. We cannot know or grow close to our brothers and sisters by meeting for an hour and 15 minutes a week with a large group in a church sanctuary. The home is the ideal place in which to build relationships and closeness. In most instances, we hardly even know one another until we get together in one another's homes, eat together, and talk with one another across the table. Much of the knowledge I have about you has come from the home time that I had with you people. Much of the time. Much of the knowledge that I have. If that wasn't there, you might be a stranger. So what we need to understand from the scripture is this, my dear brothers and sisters, there is so much spoken today about being a New Testament church, but I would like to make a bold declaration from the word of God here that there is no New Testament church life without the ministry of hospitality. Shall we all repeat this together? There is no New Testament church life without the ministry of hospitality. In other words, I would like to also make it very, very personal. You cannot be a Christian walking with the Lord if you don't practice hospitality. Because it takes people to practice hospitality. It is not practiced in the air. This brings me to the next scripture, Romans chapter 12, verse 9. I'm telling you why I read this before I make my point here. First I put Romans 12, 13, but then I was thinking about, actually this should be connected to the previous verse. Because Paul says here, Romans 12, 9, let love be genuine. Why does he say love be genuine? Because you can fake love, isn't it? Fake lovers. Oh, they express great words and they show some superficial affection, but there is no deep concern for one another. And that's the reason Paul says here, the word of God says here, let your love be genuine, authentic, unique, extraordinary. Don't be a fake, superficial person. And one of the ways you can show your genuine love is in the form of the principles Paul laid in Romans chapter 12, one of which we find in verse 13. What does it say here? In verse 13, contribute to the needs of the saints, and it says here, seek to show hospitality. Seek to show hospitality. Now, if a person says that I love the church, I love my brothers and sisters, but closes his home, can that love be genuine? No. That love cannot be genuine. The Greek word, you know, I love the word there, seek to show hospitality. Do you know what is seek? We know that, you know, the word that is used in Matthew 7 very famously, right? Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and you shall find. And knock and the door will be opened unto you. You know, seek means in Greek, chasing. Pursuing. When the Bible says that, seek to show hospitality means you need to be looking for whom should I invite? How should I show hospitality? You know, you'll be pursuing. You will be chasing. It's not that someone tells you, Davana calls me and tells, hey, Brother Stephen, would you like to invite Rajesh family? They are new to the church. And would you like to invite them for hospitality? I'll talk to my wife and let you know. And it's a good privilege, by the way, to invite people home and to have them. It's not that, wow, what a great opportunity for me to be a blessing to someone. That is exactly what the Bible says, that you need to run after, chase, and pursue to show hospitality. How many of them do you find in the churches today who pursue, run after, and Love to show hospitality. Alexander Strock, again, to bring him, he shares with that it doesn't take people long to figure out there is a churchy love among Christians. Wow, I love the word. Say that, churchy love. Churchy love. You know what is churchy love? That love that is shown only in the Sunday service. Hey, brother, how are you? So nice to meet you. You are so nice. And God be with you. God bless you, brother. Stay away from my home, by the way, in the heart. But hallelujah, praise the Lord. I love you. I pray for you. May the Lord reward me richly. It says churchy love among Christians that ends at the back door of the sanctuary or in the parking lot. It is a superficial Sunday morning only kind of love that is unwilling to extend itself beyond the walls of the church building. Unless we open the doors of our homes to one another, the reality of the local church as a close, knit family of loving brothers and sisters is just one more empty religious theory. It's just sheer hypocrisy, shallowness. It is through the ministry of hospitality that we provide the fellowship and care that nurtures true brotherly and sisterly love. I hope and pray that may the Spirit of the Lord take these scriptures and enlighten you, convict you, and provoke you to be a family, to be a woman and man of hospitality. How many of you believe that we are living in end times? How many of you believe that? Why do you believe that you are in end times? How are you preparing for end times? People think that one of the ways to prepare for end times is be on your knees and keep looking in your eyes and heart to heaven. Lord, come soon. Here am I eagerly waiting for you. Being on the knees is a sign of you waiting eagerly for the kingdom of heaven, is what I have been taught when I became a Christian. But when I read the end time disciplines of a Christian in 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 7 till 9, I was shaken. Shaken. 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 7 to 9. Now, follow me carefully, people. This is a very interesting one. The end of all things is at hand. We are close. The end time is close and we are going to be raptured when the Lord Jesus Christ comes and we are going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. And most importantly, the judgment seat we are all about to face, which Cyril is preaking these days, the Bema, seat of Christ. The judgment is near. The end is near. Therefore, he says about four things what to do, but I'm highlighting only one thing because that's the crux of the message today. He says here that, therefore, the end of all things is near. Therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. So what is the first thing you should be doing? Be devoted to prayers. And I have gave an expositional sermon maybe 2 years back that this is speaking about corporate prayers. I proved it from the scripture. And if please remind me, I can send that sermon to you. 1 hour sermon I have given 2 years ago, 2-3 years ago. If you haven't been there, listen to this and argued that this scripture speaks about corporate prayers. And I know Telugu church. You know Telugu church, Sajiva Sakshila Samajam. Every day they gather for 1 hour for church, 9 to 10 p.m. Do you know that? And people, some of us grumble here for half an hour. And that too, you know, just Tuesdays and Fridays. My goodness, what do you do with the scriptures? That speaks about in the end times, you need to be a praying church. Praying church. Above all, second it says, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers multitude of sins. So in other words, he's telling in the end times, what you should be doing? Keep forgiving. Keep forgiving one another as an expression of love. And the third thing he says, one of the most crucial activities on the end times. You know what he says? Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. How do you prepare for the Lord's coming, brothers and sisters? Go to church on every Sunday and dress well and greet people and sing songs and give an offering. That's a very, very preparation, right? That's one of the ways. There is nothing wrong. But here is an explicit, clear exhortation to believers that one of the most crucial disciplines of a Christian in the end times, one of the ways you prepare for the Lord's second coming, is by showing hospitality
to one another. So what shall we say about people who are not active in hospitality? They're not preparing for the Lord's coming. What shall we say to the people who are passive in hospitality? They are not aware of the end times. And they are not practicing this discipline seriously. And it says over here, show hospitality to one another, which is in the context of the local church. And there is a very two important words that has been added here. What does it say? Without grumbling, which means the grumbling should be out from the hospitality. It should not be with grumbling. When you show hospitality with grumbling, it doesn't please God and it is not rewarding activity that we will be doing. Now, when the Bible says that, it doesn't say that in the previous one, pray without grumbling, it doesn't say that. And it doesn't say here that serve one another in the 10th verse without grumbling. It doesn't say that. But when it comes to hospitality, it says that show hospitality to one another without grumbling. Why do you think it says? Why do you think it says? You know, when we grumble, I'll tell you one tip. It seems that you're not grumblers. You are very nice, I don't know what to say. I use the word gulbaji in Telugu. You know gulbaji? Gulgutane untaru. So I say that he's a good gulbaji man. Keeps on grumbling. So, you know, anything that is difficult, we grumble. We don't grumble against, you know, easy things. Anything that is a difficult thing, we grumble. You know, church, if you tell them 2-3 times, it's a difficult thing, right? You grumble. If your work is stretched in your workplace, you grumble because it is difficult. Anything that is easy, we don't grumble. So what does it show here? It shows that hospitality is a messy, hard, laborious work which generally, by nature, by default, we won't be excited to do that. That's one of the reasons some of you are not very active in hospitality because it is strenuous. It is laborious. And you don't want to pay the price for that. And that's the reason some wives grumble when husband says that, hey, I'm thinking. You know very well, okay? You know about your heart. You know about your situation. How many wives grumble when a husband says, why can't we invite this family to our home? Are they excited? Ah, wow, that's very nice. Yeah, let's do that. Let's invite this family. Or will they blah, 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 keep on grumbling? And then how many of husbands grumble? Don't think that husbands don't grumble. Husbands are also good gulbajis. They'll also grumble saying that when wife says that, let us invite, because they don't want to take the risk. They don't want to take efforts in that. And the Bible cautions here, brothers and sisters, a Christian should not be, when it comes to showing hospitality, Christians should be excited. They should not be grumbling. And if you grumble, it shows that your heart is not right with God. Your heart doesn't understand the eternal values that the Bible speaks about. There is a word that I would like to, there is a statement that I have put here that I want to tell you here. Showing hospitality costs personal time, extra money, mental stress, and physical exhaustion, cooking and killing. However, it is worth nothing to what Christ did on the cross to bring us to his eternal home. Is it anything worth taking? I'm telling you that every time our family shows hospitality, we are gone. We go to bed like dead people. And I praise God, my sons and wife and all of us are involved in that. But it is a very exhausting thing. I'm telling you that. So exhausting that you don't want to do it. But it is worth taking the efforts because it is nothing compared to what Christ did for us on the cross. The suffering he underwent on the cross. And here this another thing. And it is worth making the effort knowing God will reward us richly on the last day. It is worth nothing compared to what Christ suffered on the cross. And it is worth taking the efforts knowing that God will reward us on the last day. People, I'm telling you that I was talking to some brother and he told me that a lot of people do in the workplace but they don't do in the church because they make money in the workplace and they don't get money in the church. Only a person who lives with eternity and his eyeballs will do things that people generally do because knowing that the reward is in the kingdom of heaven. why Danny and Krishna should slog and arrange this church camp and running around, putting so much of efforts, what money they will get? Not a penny they will get for all the efforts they have taken here. And some of you volunteered and working hard and arranging this. You know how much stress it is to organize a church camp like this? Why are they doing this? Why some of you are doing hospitality? You won't get anything. You are only losing. The only hope is that Christ died for me, which is worth the effort, and God is going to reward me. Without that eternal perspective, you cannot live a sacrificial life. So I say this, hospitality is risky, but rewarding. Shall we all say this together? Hospitality is risky, but rewarding. Lack of hospitality is comfortable, but also catastrophic. So people, let's be devoted to hospitality. There is one word that I would like to encourage you. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. And that is one of the verses I often write and give to some of you when you work hard for the church. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. Shall we all read this together? Maybe we will all stand and read this together as an honor to this beautiful scripture. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. I'm not telling you to stand and read, not because you're feeling sleepy. I don't see anyone feeling sleepy here. It is just for the sake of reverence. Okay? Because I want you to be more attentive of these words. If you can memorize, memorize it. Powerful verse. What does it say? For God is not unjust so as to overlook your work and the love that you have shown for his name in serving the saints as you still do. Just allow that verse to sink into your hearts, people. Allow that. God will not forget. People may forget it. God will not. Even a cup of water, Bible says that, you will by no means lose your reward. God is making a note of every good work that you are doing, and he will reward you richly. Don't expect your reward here. But the time will come, God will honor it. Please be seated. You know, one of the beautiful sisters in the Bible, I really appreciate the questions there. There were no sisters. This sister should be one of our heroines in showing hospitality in Acts chapter 16, verse 15. It says here that, and after she, Lydia, a new born again believer, we don't see this, you know, when people are born again, this is their activity and they're very earnest in that. We see here that after Lydia was baptized and her household as well, you see the word here, she urged us. You know what it means literally? Begged us. She was begging, please, please consider this. She was urging, saying, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house and stay. She did not invite them to come to my house and have a meal, which is easier, right? Just have a meal, get out, then we have other things to do. But she says, stay here, because they were itinerant speakers and apostles and going here and there. And please come and stay for a few days. We don't know how many days. And you know what the Bible says? They were not willing, actually. It shows very clearly. The language shows that the apostles were really uneasy to stay in a house. And you see how it ends here. And she prevailed upon us. And that too, not just Paul people. Observe the word plural. If you read the whole context, there were a couple of companions along with him. And they all stayed in her house. Just imagine how she used to get up early in the morning and prepare the food, clean it. And you know how painful it is to have guests in your house. There are movies being taken on having guests in your house. And there are some articles written how to lovingly, you know, kick out the guests from your house if they stay for more than affordable days. There are articles written also. You can go and check in the Google. How to really get rid of guests who are staying for more days than it is required. And here we see that she prevailed. What a godly woman she was. People, do we urge people to come for hospitality? Do we have this earnest? You don't find any grumbling attitude here. She was very excited, counted it as a privilege and a blessing to do that. I love what Helga Henry, I'm sure that many of you don't know Carl Hefech Henry. He was one of the brilliant thinkers of Christianity who wrote volumes of books. It takes actually for a year to read at least his one book. The language and the comms, a brilliant theologian he was. His wife said this, Christian hospitality is not a matter of choice. It is not a matter of money. It is not a matter of age, social standing, sex, or personality. Christian hospitality is a matter of obedience to God. So we all repeat the statement, the final statement. Christian hospitality is a matter of obedience to God. It is not man's word. We have seen Acts, we have seen Romans, we have seen 1 Peter 4, 9. Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. It is God who commanded. And if you don't practice, you're not obeying God. John Hennerman is another person, a good author. He says here, for believers, hospitality is not an option. Do you hear this? Hospitality is not an option. If we are not showing hospitality in our homes, we are not listening to God's word. You may be very good in doing quiet time in the morning. I'm not talking about quiet time after couples fight. I'm talking about quiet time in the morning. You may be very good in that. But you're not listening to God. Ministry begins in our homes and around our tables. Not just with people we know and love, but also with those we do not know. Some of my most significant relationships started simply inviting someone over for dinner. And he says here, I love that he says that, if you want a ministry, start with hospitality. If you want a ministry, start with hospitality. Next scripture, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2. Shall we all read this together? Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Shall we all read this again? Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. You know, in the early church, even believers or the itinerant workers, they were moving from one place to another and there were no hotels. So the only hope for them is to take their abode in some believer's house. So they are strangers. But when you know that, this person, sometimes it is given even to unbelievers. But most importantly, it was given to believers because they wanted to show that love to the universal church as well. You know, when we see here, what is very interesting over here is that it says not neglect. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers. And it says that some have did this in the past, and in doing so, they have entertained very angels. Who are those people? Abraham and? We forget another person actually, Lot. I mean, I see that Lot was a crazy guy than Abraham. You know why? Let me just read this. You can't imagine how this guy would say that. It says in Genesis 9, just follow carefully and pay attention to the scripture. The two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. When Lot saw them, he rose to meet them and bowed himself with his face to the earth and said, "My lords, please turn aside to your servant's house and spend the night and wash your feet. Then you may rise up early and go on your way." Now, Lot didn't know that they were angels. Remember that. They were strangers. He just went. You see the way he bowed before them. He prostrated before them. And he was addressing, "My lords, come and stay." And you know what they said? "No, we will spend the night in the town square." But he pressed them strongly. Pressed them strongly. Urged them strongly. So they turned aside to him and entered his house. And he made them a feast and baked unleavened bread. And they ate. But before they lay down, the men of the city, the men of Sodom, both young and old, all the people to the last man, surrounded the house. And they called to Lot, "Where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us, that we may know them." Which means that we may have sex with them. Homosexuals, gays. They were there right before in Sodom, centuries before. "We want to rape them," he says that. Lot went out to the men at the entrance, shut the door after him, and said, "I beg you, my brothers, do not act so wickedly." Now you see how much these people honor the strangers rather than their own family. He says, "Your Lord, behold, I have two daughters who have not known any man. Let me bring them to you and do to them as you please. Only do nothing to these men, for they have come under the shelter of my roof." Who in a right mind would do this? Saying that, "You take my daughters, but don't take these men." I mean, the principle, the point is that how much they have honored guests. How much they have honored hospitality. That's the point. We are not talking about anything else here. And how in this way he showed hospitality and his family was pained. Praise God for this ministry of hospitality, which has been a great blessing to
these people. The other scripture that I would like to tell you, which speaks about the importance of hospitality, and this is to elders, people like us, Shankar and me and others who are about to become in the future. It says here twice. If you look at the qualifications of elders, it is spoken both in Titus chapter 1 and also 1 Timothy chapter 3. And some of those qualities are mentioned in both the letters. Some of the qualities are mentioned only in Titus, which is unmentioned in Timothy. And we see here that in both the letters, hospitality was unmistakably presented. It says here, an elder must be hospitable, a lover of good. 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 2. Therefore, an overseer must be hospitable. Twice it is mentioned that a person who is not given to hospitality is disqualified from becoming an elder. It's a very serious quality. The reason I'm mentioning is just imagine that how much the Bible speaks about hospitality, that even for a person to become an elder, he should be a person of hospitality. Or else he may be good at teaching, he may be good at doctrines, he may be good at so many things, but if he is not a minister of hospitality, he is disqualified. That is one of the reasons when we take the affirmation of the church, we ask the question, do you believe that this guy is a person devoted to hospitality? And one great example is that find is, even along with Lot, we find Abraham, right? Great example to people like us. In Genesis 18, we see that when he saw the men, he went and urged them, come and eat, come and eat. And he didn't know that they were angels, and one among them was even God. He didn't know that. He just showed, and God revealed his glory to him. You know, I tell to generally, when you look at pastors, how many of you have come from other churches? Other churches. Okay. Many of you, right? Come from other. How many of the elders or pastor invited you to their home? How many? Very few, right? Says out of 100%, 10% of the people raised their hand saying that only those people. Why? Because we all know that general truth is that pastors are known in our culture for receiving hospitality, not for showing hospitality. In fact, one of my friends, he used to say that, you know why pastor's belly is bigger than the wife? Because he goes to every home and leaves his wife at home and he builds a very good belly and wife is slim. Which is sometimes both will build because they keep roaming to different houses and that's how they build that. But that's very bad actually, that pastors in India especially, they only receive hospitality. I hardly find a pastor, even me, who are very good in showing hospitality. When Bible says that, you cannot be qualified as an elder without hospitality. I tell people that even when I take pastors, when I speak to pastors, I say that there are two platforms that you often should use to minister to people. One is the pulpit and the other is the dining table. These are the two powerful platforms through which we minister. Alexander Strock says here, many Christians are unaware that spiritual leaders are, according to the scripture, required to be hospitable. In my work as a church shepherd, I have found that the home is one of the most important tools for reaching and caring for people. Although the shepherd's ministry of hospitality may seem like a small thing, it has a great impact on people. If you doubt this, ask those to whom a shepherd has shown hospitality. Invariably, they will say that it is one of the most important, pleasant, and memorable aspects of the shepherd's ministry. It's very, very important ministry that we see. It's not even just for an elder to be qualified. Hospitality is important. It says that even for a widow to be qualified to be supported by the church, she should be a woman of hospitality. You see here, 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 9 to 10. How strong these words are. 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 9 to 10. Let a widow be enrolled if she is, when it says enrolled, it means if a widow should be qualified to be supported by the church. It says here, let a widow be enrolled if she is not less than 60 years of age, having been the wife of one husband, and having a reputation for, now you see the words over here, having a reputation for good works. Man, this woman is so devoted to good works. If she has brought up children, has shown hospitality, has washed the feet of the saints, has cared for the afflicted,
and has devoted herself to every good work. Now, people, listen to this. This also speaks about the qualities of a Christian woman. Do you know that? It says that for a woman to be enrolled, supported, this is what she should be qualified in order to be supported. In other words, he's telling that if a woman is not given to hospitality, she is not worthy to be supported by the church. That simply is telling here. Which means that no one knows actually how long your husbands will live. Right? If your husband have to be passed away, and if you should be qualified to be supported by the church, will this be your Christian qualities? Just think about this. Are you as a Christian woman known, having a reputation of good works, shown hospitality, served the saints, cared for the afflicted, and devoted to every good work? My goodness. When it comes to, there is a good balance we see here. She is devoted to her husband and brought up children. But not even that. Many are very good in just sticking to their families and not beyond that. It says that reputation of good works, hospitality, caring for the afflicted and devoted. So he's telling that if this is not there, don't take the widow to support because she has neglected her Christian calling, which is to be devoted to such things. Another scripture that I would like to show to you here is that, do you know that the Lord's Supper was celebrated as a sort of hospitality? Many people don't know this. The Lord's Supper. You know what is supper? Supper. Right? I invite Prashant and Sunita to my house and next week, and I tell them that please join us for supper, and they'll come. And then on the way, when they come home, I will give them a crumb of bread and a sip of drink, and I tell them, thank you so much for coming for hospitality. And what will they say? It happened to us when I was leading discipleship ministry. One day, an American invited us for dinner. We all went. About 10 people went. And he took us to a pizza house and he gave us pizza. And then we thought, my goodness, starter is great. What would be the next thing? And then he says, thank you for joining for supper. And good to have you and see you later, he said. We all looked at each other. What is this humiliation that we are facing here? They had to go back and cook food and eat. You know why I say this? We use the word Lord's Supper. Do you understand Lord's Supper is? The Greek word is dipnon, which means banquet, meal. Lord's Supper today, 99.99% of the churches have Lord's crumb and sip. It is not the Lord's Supper. But originally, every Greek scholar, Bible scholar agrees that the Lord's Supper was a meal practiced in the homes of one another. We see that very clearly in 1 Corinthians 11, 20 to 22. I don't have to bring from elsewhere. Even Acts chapter 2, 46 to 47 that I quoted earlier, many argue that that's a Lord's Supper that they were eating in one another's homes, having a meal together. It says here, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, what is happening? Each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry. One goat gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. So what's happening here? There were some people who were bringing the food, probably the rich and wealthy people, is because it says that you are despising those who have nothing. So there were people who brought the food and they were sharing with the poor, and in this way they were hauling, having the Lord's Supper. It was a fellowship and the community meal. But they were bringing the food and eating beforehand so that they have nothing to share with others. And Paul was angry and he was telling that this is not the Lord's Supper, your own supper you are doing that. And what is the, in the culmination, what does he give the antidote, the remedy for this? In verse 33 he says, so then my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. Right? Donald Guthrie, the New Testament scholar, says that in the early church, the Lord's Supper took place in the course of a communal meal. All brought what food they could and it was shared together. Leon Morris, also a New Testament scholar, he says that at Corinth, the Holy Communion was not simply a token meal as with us, but an actual meal. Moreover, it seems clear that it was a meal to which each of the participants brought food. Now hear this carefully, brothers and sisters. That is one reason I don't compromise on fellowship meal. Never. never compromised from the day I began the church. One reason why we have, some of you are very new, but older people know that I even take 3 to 4 hours proving that it was a fellowship meal from the Bible, from history, that we cannot have a meeting of the church without fellowship meal. Because in breaking the bread, it is a vertical thing that we remember. When we have fellowship together and eat together, it is a horizontal relationship. So Lord's Supper is both vertical and horizontal. And that is a form of showing hospitality. Some of you are, when you sponsor, it is a hospitality that you need to understand that you have supported the church. And people, you know, just eat. Don't even go and, you know, just put a word and say thank you for that. I had to tell Krishna, actually, you know, just put a thank you word, because I know how many people take hospitality for granted without being grateful, without being very grateful. So he puts on behalf of the people saying that, you know, thank you for showing hospitality. But it is a good job when people do that, and God will bless them. Finally, I want to touch this one, two verses, and then I will close. One is Romans chapter 18, 16 verse 22. Romans 16 verse 22, 23, it says, shall we read this together? Gaius, who is host to me and to the whole church, greets you. You know, it says about two things. One is, who is host to me, that is, he was showing hospitality to Christian workers, which is very good. And in Telugu states, many people, I think, do that hospitality to, you know, Christian pastors and all, which is very common. But the other thing that we see here is, he says that not only to me, but to the, can you understand, can you imagine the whole church gathering in his house and he's showing hospitality? Can you imagine that? Who is host to me is another word, is nothing but, NIV also translates that, whose hospitality I and the whole church enjoys. Imagine children, different people, messing up the whole house. My goodness, what a great family of hospitality. You know, many of us thank God. Many of you thank God. Lord, I thank you. I believe that in every housewarming, we should preach on hospitality. Because we thank God for the houses God has given to us. Many of us are owning our houses. You know, one of the great ways that we can express our gratitude for blessing us with a house is by using our house for the glory of God in the form of hospitality. That shows the Lord, I'm grateful. I'm a conduit, not a cul-de-sac. I'm not a dead end receiving. That's the reason one of my caption of my life that I've written is, there is no greater blessing than being a blessing. No greater blessing than being a blessing. Now I want to close with this radical couple who is a perfect balance of all the three kinds of ministries, Aquila and Priscilla. Please turn to Romans chapter 16, verse 3 to 5. First, I want to touch the church part. Okay? Romans 16, 3 to 5. Greet Prisca and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who risked their necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but all the churches of the Gentiles give thanks as well. And then he says, greet also the church in their house. Greet also the church in their house. The church was gathering. It is a well-known fact that the early church primarily gathered in the homes of Christian believers. And these people opened their home so that believers can gather in their home. Children, older people, younger people gathering. Imagine the noise. In the first, there was no separate room for Sunday school. No separate teaching. You know, just we want to send the Sunday school so that we can be away from distraction. Everyone was there in the house. Imagine the mess that they might be created. And people even ate. I told you, right? Lord's Supper was celebrated in the form of a fellowship meal. And people might have brought the food. And maybe the water was there. And the food was loitered over there. Imagine what a mess it was. And this family, week after week, hosted this church in their house. Praise be to God for this godly couple, Aquila and Priscilla. And then they also showed hospitality to Christian workers. We see that in Acts chapter 18, verse 1 to 3. After this, Paul left Athens and went to Corinth. And he found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, recently came from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all the Jews to leave Rome. And he went to see them. And because he was one of the same trade, it says here that Paul stayed with them and worked. for they were tent makers by trade. I was doing a study of what it means when he stayed, and some of the people highlighted that he stayed in the home of Aquila and Priscilla. You know how many months he stayed? 18 months. He stayed with Aquila and Priscilla. Wow. How greatly they were devoted to hospitality. And not only that, they hosted new believers also. We see that in Acts chapter 18, verse 26. He, Apollos, began to speak boldly in the synagogue, but when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. NIV puts that, he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Priscilla and Aquila heard him, the language is such that they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. So what do we see? They hosted the church. They ministered to the Christian workers, and they discipled new people. Invited, discipled, spent time with them. People, I'm telling you, the more you are aging, the more you should be looking for young people in the church. I was talking recently to one of the old brothers and told that people like you are a gem in the church. Old people, invite them to your homes. Spend time with the new believers. Invest your life in them. That's a great blessing. I really praise God for Brother Benjamin, who did this wonderful work at the age of 60s. I was so glad when, you know, just 1 week ago he called me and said, that, brother, can I take Joy for a fellowship meal? I pleaded with some brothers in the church, but this brother I never asked. He called himself and he said that, I want to take. He took him and he had a meal with him, and Joy came with great encouragement. Why should he do that at the age of 60s? I know so many 60s people who will be slumbering when preaching is going on, because they think that the only thing they have to wait is for the grave. And these guys are investing their lives, inviting people, and they have a fully 100% autistic child at home. Inviting people, and you know, some of you went to their house with all the challenges, how much they are showing doing that. And some of you, I know that they are you are also aging, and how you are showing hospitality. I'm telling you, you know, I was telling to someone yesterday that when I look at, you know, these young brothers like Krishna and Jeevan and Leela and all these, you know, brothers, I long to see them how they will be at the age of 60s. I'm sure that people like Dil and, you know, Ajay and Vinay and all these, you guys will be rocking at the age of 60s. Inviting people, discipling them, pouring your life into their hearts. What a great blessing to end with. What a great ending that would be, right? Before you finish, what a great ending that would be. Pouring your life into the lives of other people. And I want to counsel also those who are young people who are getting married. Make sure that the woman whom you are marrying, make sure that she is a woman of hospitality. Don't marry a woman who is not given to hospitality, for that would be a great stumbling block. She will be keep on grumbling whenever you want to invite. Why? And she will bite your ear and make your life miserable. So make sure that you look for this great quality of hospitality. I want to close with this quote. Shall we all stand together? It is by Christina Fox. It is strange, as most of the books on hospitality is written by women. Hospitality is an act of service that helps us share the love of Christ with others. God calls each of us to practice hospitality, whether it comes easy or not. And for those of us who hesitate for one reason or another, it becomes an act of obedience to our Savior, who has opened his own home for us through his shed blood on the cross. How can we do any less than open our own hearts and homes to others? May the Lord convict you and propel you for every good work. Heavenly Father, I preach to your word, and give me the grace to practice more what I am preaching. Be a man of hospitality. Be a man devoted to good works, including my wife and sons. From generation to generations, may we be a family leaving a legacy of hospitality. Pray, Lord, for all the families here who have listened, even for the singles. Beg you to please to soften our hearts and help us to take efforts. Lord, it's an effort. It's a great effort. Help us to take that efforts to practice hospitality. Put into practice what we have heard. If you are doing little, may we do more. If we are doing more, may we do much more. And if we are not doing anything, may we start doing it. May we become a church of hospitality. When the question is asked and the six options is given, what comes to your mind when you think about church? Let hospitality come in one of the great marks of a healthy church. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who loved us, who invited us to his eternal home, and help us to be that conduits in your hands, the instruments in your hands, and be a blessing, we offer this prayer. Amen.